you for joining us. My name is Dilip Saraf for Tycon Live, and with me today I have Jessica Jacquelie Flannery of Kiva, co-founder of Kiva, right? And we just came from a panel about an hour ago, and the reading I got from the audience as a result of your presentation during the panel especially, as well as panel's general message, there is a lot of interest in that social business, social enterprise. And I was fascinated to see that people somehow gravitated to your message. What is your message that's so compelling?
Gosh, well, I'm a little biased. I might be the wrong person to ask, but Kiva, as you know, I usually start off talks by stating our mission, which is to connect people through lending for poverty alleviation. And I love our mission, and it's something we reference a lot. And there's a purity of mission there, where you know we're not seeking to do anything else. We're seeking to do that, and other great things may follow, and that's wonderful. But we're not seeking to just raise a lot of money really quickly. We're seeking to connect people.
Right.
And I think fundamentally, Kiva offers, you said the message. So I guess the message of Kiva is, hey, the world is made up of people like you and me. And everybody has the opportunity in a really easy, sustainable way to, you know, with as little as $25 as sort of the tool for connectivity, to contribute and empower someone else on the other side of the planet. So I guess there are a few things going on there. One is everybody can get involved right now in a very immediate way, in a very specific way, in another person's life. The other thing that goes on with Kiva is that I think this, I was able to, and I'm thankful for this opportunity, I was able to tell kind of the founding story of Kiva, and it really came out of this very, very simple idea. So I think, I'm guessing.
Can you tell us?
Sure.
What that is,
please? Oh, sure. I think that's interesting to people and makes them feel like, hey, I could do that too. So, you know, it's spring 2008. Now, 4 years ago, I quit my job at Stanford because I was really compelled by this idea of microfinance. And I went to live in East Africa for a little while to learn about it and to interview entrepreneurs who had started businesses with just $100, $100 or $300. And basically, I was overwhelmed and really deeply moved by their stories of success. So their stories over and over again were just intriguing and interesting, and they weren't all, you know, absolute financial successes all the time, but positive change had occurred in those individuals' lives. First and foremost, because they had had the opportunity to change their own lives and to access capital and a resource that hadn't been there for them before. And that opportunity changed the way they thought about themselves and were hopeful about the future. So that was amazing right then and there. But also, the improvements in standard of living were really interesting. Like, one family may have used the extra income from the business to put a lock on their door, and that represented security for them. Another family might have invested in nutrition or education or something else, but people had agency and choice and were able to have more control over how their families' lives were improving. So that was really neat, and I became really obsessed with these stories. I called my husband, Matt, who was back in San Francisco, and my friends and family, and wrote these long emails describing the story. So I started to write these case studies, these stories of people that I had met. And the nature of the stories is such that they're cliffhangers. So naturally, you hear about this amazing, you know, goat herder who used $100 to go from below to above the poverty line. And you think, that's real? That's a real person? What's next? I want to participate in that story. I want to connect. I want to do something to be a part of that amazing story. So basically, Kiva grew out of this very fundamental desire to connect our friends and family in the United States, mostly, with friends and family across the globe, and to allow them to contribute, you know, a little bit of money to the loan needs of very specific individuals we met. And from there, it's grown. And maybe this is something else that speaks to people. Out of that very basic idea, things have just, you know, you hitch up the power of the internet to, you know, even a very simple idea like we had, and it's just this limitless potential that happens with that combination. So our beta round with Kiva was $3,000 from our, we spammed our wedding list, and we collected $3,000 for seven businesses, seven entrepreneurs in Uganda. That was the first 6 months, and it worked. So we continued. The second year, you know, we added more businesses, emailed more than just our wedding list, and kind of opened the site up a little wider. And the first year of operation officially was, we did $500,000 in loans, and these $25 little bits. The second year was $17 million. So we went $3,000, $500,000, $17 million, and today, Kiva raises about $1 million in loans every 9 to 12 days on the site. So the potential for fast growth, even with a very simple idea, I think is probably compelling.
And how many people are you affecting with that kind of money, which is not a lot of money?
Yeah, so it's one other neat thing about Kiva is that it's not just let's put money over here to these people. There's a change that happens with everybody involved, I think. So it's about 300,000 lenders as of today, as of May 2008. 300,000 lenders, a little over $30 million that they have put in to the site, and that has been distributed through about 95 microfinance institutions that are our partners on the ground in about 45 countries to like 40,000 plus entrepreneurs. So there's this big cloud of people that are affected, right. And what's neat is seeing lenders and entrepreneurs connect and to see those lines between rich and poor, or big powerful donor and poor needy beneficiary, kind of be blown out of the water, and
right.
You just see people lending to people, and we have Mexicans lending to other Mexicans. We have, eventually, wouldn't it be neat to see Ugandans lending to a farmer who needs money in Nebraska? I mean, it'd be great to see all these lines blur,
right.
And to just see people empowering each other.
But it looks like, based on the way you're projecting it, not only have you transformed them, but they have transformed you.
Oh my gosh, I feel really lucky. Yeah. People talk about nonprofits and think, there's a lot of altruism, and that's all true, but really I feel very selfish because I get to do a job that I love. I get to interact with people that are downright inspiring. I get a lot from being able to be part of this.
And they pay back the money, right? That's the most amazing part,
yeah.
I think. Which is,
yeah. So repayment rates in microfinance, we can call that, it's an umbrella term for sort of financial services for the poor, but then microcredit,
right.
Small loans for the poor is really what Kiva focuses on, and repayments rates in microcredit products are usually over 90-95%. Mm-hmm. Kiva's match that, and there's a lot of reasons that's the case, mm-hmm. but it often comes back to just the drive of the entrepreneurs and the real expertise in expertise of the microfinance institutions and making sure that there's accountability and support for them to succeed.
So if they want to get in touch with you, they can call
entrepreneurs,
Kiva.org, or people who want to invest in your ventures.
Oh my goodness, absolutely.
Kiva.org is the
Kiva.org, yep. Okay. We bought Kiva.com too, but it's officially Kiva.org. And my email is jessica@kiva.org. Anyone can email.
Good.
Make sure they talk to the right person.
No, this is fascinating.
Thank you so
much.
Thank
you very much, Jessica.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank
Jessica
you.
Jessica Jackley Flannery from Kiva. And this is Dilip Saraf. If you want to see more episodes of this many times over, please go to mytycon.org and visit as many as you like. Thank you.